light, like a jazz waltz. I was doing, this is one that I did on my jazz on Sunday, jazz hymns out a while ago.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Advent Lutheran Church on this 16th Sunday after Pentecost, and a beautiful morning it is. My name's Pastor Matt, and I'm glad to see you all here. A couple brief announcements. This morning, We've got an ice cream social to celebrate the beginning of Christian Ed Sunday School and the fall regular church calendar year and all the activities and stuff that go on at this time. So we've got that. So thank you to who all? Council. Council is hosting the ice cream social. So we got that this morning. We've got in your bulletin, there's lots of things in here. We've got praise band and vocal choir starting September 20th. Thursday night Bible study. We were going to start this past Thursday, but not all the books came in. There was a delay in delivery. You can still get involved with that. This is the book. I think we got one or two extra on hand. And even if you do order it and it doesn't come until after this Thursday, you can join on and follow the conversation because it'll be like general overview. So the book is not absolutely necessary, but it'll be nice to have it. So you can order and still be on board with it. So, and we're studying the life of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. We've got affirmation of baptism on Sunday, September 24th. We've got over 20 people signed up to actually come forward and affirm their baptism. So we've got that going on. 60th anniversary, Sunday, October 8th. There's a please reply by September 17th. That's today in regards to your planning to come. So if you haven't kind of put your RSVP in, and there is a cost to cost. There's forms on the table in the back in the narthex area. Please do that ASAP. Stitch Club, there's an announcement in there. There was one more thing I was going to lift up. Any other announcements that need to be made? Okay. Joys and concerns. Or not joys and concerns. Names to be added to the prayer list for the prayers of intercession. Anybody in need of prayer? Amy? Victoria? Julie. Elizabeth. Sophie. Without further ado, please rise as you are able. Let us begin our worship service with the confession and forgiveness found on the opening page of our bulletin. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus Christ who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sins. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. You are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others, for the harm we have caused. Known and unknown, forgive us for the unjust demands we place on others and your creation. Forgive us for the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor. Forgive us Lead us back to you and set us on right path. For the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And at this time, does anybody want to come forward for a children's passage?
Yes, no. Sorry, I don't see any takers. John, take it away.
The first reading is from Genesis 50, beginning at the 15th verse. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave us this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones. In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Let us read responsibly from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits.
Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the grave and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's.
O Lord, you provide vindication and justice for all who are oppressed.
You made known your ways to Moses and your works to the children of Israel.
Lord, you are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
You will not always accuse us, nor will you keep your anger forever. You have not dealt with
us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is your steadfast love for those who fear you.
As far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our transgressions from us.
As a father has compassion for his children, so you have compassion for those who fear you, O Lord. The second reading is from Romans, the 14th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some people believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. Those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you deserve your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 18th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii and seized him by the throat. He said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us continue with prayer. You may be seated. Gracious God, we give you thanks that we can be here in your house, our sanctuary. Open our hearts by your Holy Spirit to know your love through your word, that we may share that love with the world around us. May the thoughts and meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you. Amen. There's a movie quote that comes to mind, that came to mind to me this week as I was studying the text. The line is, it's not personal, it's business. Anybody have an idea what movie that's from? It's an older movie. Let me try it again. It's not personal, it's business. Yes, right out the gate, yes. Anybody else, was anybody else thinking Godfather? It's okay, everybody can raise their hand, whether you were or not, it's all right. Yes, yes, the Godfather. It's personal, not business. I think it was when Salazzo was talking to, am I going to be noun challenged again this sermon like I was at the first service? Michael, upon shooting his father, Don Corleone. It's not personal, it's business. Why? Why did that come to mind? Of all things. Jesus' parable here is a parable, and there can be a temptation to read it and think it purely in terms of metaphor or allegory, but it's a parable. What does all that mean? That there's a tendency to read this and take the economic punch out of it, in a sense, to read it, well, the king represents, or the owner, whatever, the master represents God. The slave, that the master forgives the exorbitant debt. And when it says 10,000 talents, that's like saying a kajillion today. I mean, it's just a wild amount of money that is beyond imagination, like just two gobs of money. So the slave that owns, you know, gajillions of dollars to the master represents us, and that the other slave represents, that owes us money, represents our neighbor. And that God forgives us exorbitantly, and therefore we should forgive. And that's just this, we kind of forget the money part. We kind of just not read it there. But here's the thing. The number one topic Jesus speaks about when he teaches those around him is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is like, the kingdom of God can be compared to, you know, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like, and that's mentioned in this teaching. And the second topic thing that Jesus mentions more than anything else in all his teachings is also in our lesson today. Anybody want to take a guess as to what that might be? Based on the trajectory of the sermon so far, it's mentioned in the text too, almost immediately after kingdom of God. Yes, money. Yes, money. Years past, I would have pulled out a dollar bill. But hey, these days, you can do almost as much with this thing, and in some ways more than you can with the dollar bill, right? Feedback from me. Oh, yeah. Maybe that's the indicator as to how far. Yeah, right here. Okay. There we go. Oh, there's that one too. Okay. Anyways, what does this represent? Money, yeah. Where's the money? Where's the money? When I use this, where does the money come from? A bank account. The money that is in the bank account, where does that come from? And it is a debit card, so yeah, it's not drawing on credit. The money that's in the bank account that this is connected to, where does that money come from? A paycheck, yes. How many of you have one of these? How many of you get a paycheck that gets deposited into that checking account? And let's say you're retired, right? You might get a Social Security check, or a dividend check, or a check from your 501(c)(3) or whatever. That's usually money that came to you in a paycheck, or was deducted and put in there before you got your paycheck. But still, it's money that you worked for at some point that goes in here. And you benefit from that. Where's the money that you work for? Where does that come from? And what essentially is a paycheck? When somebody gives you money in a paycheck, why are they giving you money as a paycheck? Perfect answer. Service render. I do a service
that benefits someone else, and then I get paid for it. This is like a measuring tool, money. And it was invented. It hasn't always been around. In fact, for most of our existence on this planet, we human beings bartered and traded. You didn't have money. You would work in raising your flock. You would work going out hunting. You would work by harvesting. You would work by producing clothing. You would work by cooking. You would work maintaining the tribal camp. You would work, and that work that you did didn't just benefit you, but it benefited everyone around you. It benefited the community. That money does not exist without relationship. If you were stranded on a deserted island, the choice between having $1 billion in gold in a chest or a couple months' supplies of food and water, what would you prefer? You'd be stuck on a visit. You don't know for how long. Right, because if you take the gold and you're there for 2 months, or maybe forever because you die, the gold doesn't do you much good. There's no one to buy anything from. You can't buy food. You need a community. You need relationship. That's the only way that this has value. When societies collapse, money has no value. My family lost everything when the banks collapsed in Finland during the Finnish-Russo War, right before World War II. When they came to the United States because the society was collapsing. How many of you have done work for which you were not paid for? Yeah? If you don't, being a stay-at-home parent, yeah. And that's an economic, I had to make that decision. I was the stay-at-home parent for almost a year because to get child care, to pay for child care so that I could go work during that time frame, it cost more to do child care than I would have been able to earn working in that in-between period between congregations. And so economically, we would just break even. We'd probably make about $200 on the whole after the calculation. It just made a whole lot more sense for me to stay home, take care of the kids. Yeah, it became a dollars and cents decision. Anybody here who has changed a diaper did work that they did not get paid for. And if it was anybody else's kid, some stranger's kid, they probably couldn't pay you enough to change that diaper. Correct? It's not personal, it's business. The reason why Jesus uses money so often as he teaches, whether he's teaching about the kingdom of God or other aspects of being community, is because money is about relationship. And there are so many ways that money can be used to abuse relationship. That It is business and it is personal. That, wow. That's on an individual level and on a societal level. Anybody here familiar with Shay's Rebellion? Shay's Rebellion happened right after the Revolutionary War. George Washington's soldiers got pay and land. And this was throughout the colonies. And all the colonies, which were now states, all had debt from the war. And to pay that debt, they upped the taxes. And the land that was given to the veterans, our very first veterans, were out in the country because that's where land was available to pay them with. Because the population density was so much lower there, they did not have as much of a vote in the capitals of those states to influence how the taxes were levied in order to pay back the debt from the war. And a lot of veterans found themselves paying taxes so burdensome that they were being thrown in debtor's prison or their properties were being foreclosed. So they rebelled. First place they took was a tax collection office, and a guy by the name of Daniel Shay, who'd been an officer in the Revolutionary War, kind of became their leader. And the banks and the wealthy in Boston were getting, you know, they were making out on the properties that were collected. To resolve the issue, they ended up forgiving the debt of the veterans. There were people who were not veterans who were suffering under the taxes as well and losing their properties, but at least for the veterans, because of their service to their nation, they did debt forgiveness. These onerous taxes. It also sparked the impetus to really form the Constitution. One of the reasons they kind of hurried up a little faster. We got to come up with a centralized government to deal with these type of issues. That's another concern. There's lots of economic theories out there and economic priorities that our society has and that we, given where we stand, even in our politics, may take. I like the Shay's Rebellion thing. I find it really interesting because it kind of captures both. You know, taxes that are too high, lower taxes, smaller government, and debt forgiveness. What is just? What is too onerous? Taxation without representation. The deeper question for us here in this room are not what are the economic policies and theories of one flavor or another as they're presented out there, but what is a Christian economic perspective? What does money mean to Jesus? And here's what it all boils down to. For Jesus, whenever he mentions money in Scripture, it always is about strengthening relationships, strengthening community. So it is personal. It's all personal. It's interpersonal. Amen. let us profess the Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We pray for the church. Bless the missions and ministries of congregations, that they uplift the good news of salvation in ways that can be understood. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and healing up to rivers clogged with pollution. Enrich the soil for trees and plants. Protect the crops needed to feed those who hunger. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for all who govern. Encourage those in positions of power to lead with empathy, practice forgiveness, and care for those who struggle. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for our neighbors who face illness of any kind. For those strained financially, for all living with chronic pain, mental illness, the disease of addiction, or otherwise afraid or in harm's way. Protect all who cry out for mercy, especially Dave, Sally, Jerry, Bill, Tony, Tim, Patty, Amy, Victoria, Julie, Elizabeth, Sophie, Bella, Matthew, R.C., Braden, Frank, and Jean, and those we say out loud or in our hearts. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for Advent Church. Open our hearts to practice intentional invitation. Help us to forgive each other. Practice patience and choose welcome over judgment. Move us to care for those in our community seeking refuge and safety. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We give thanks for the saints who died in faith. Show us how to live faithfully, creatively, and lovingly in your church and world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace, Lord, be with you. If you had not done so before the service, you are welcome to do so afterwards, and that is leave an offering in the plate towards the back of the sanctuary, or clicking the link in your digital bulletin online or at the church website. Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray as Jesus teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now for those who are communing in the pew or online. Body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Please rise as you are able. Let us pray. Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Christ Jesus, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine down upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace. God is at work in you.